Thank you for joining us on The Truth About God as we continue our series through Psalms entitled The Well. Here's Pastor Barry.
Open your Bibles to Psalm 27. Psalm 27 this morning. And I have to say, our psalm I have viewed as kind of a rare diamond in the midst of a diamond field, so to speak. It is equal in beauty and value to others, but there's a rarity to it, like you might find in any place where gems are discovered. They all are gorgeous, they all are beautiful, but there are some that stand out, and I do believe Psalm 27 is just such a psalm. Now, we have encountered in our trips to the well different types of psalms. We have encountered royal psalms, which exalt the majesty of our God. We have encountered Zion psalms, psalms that elevate in our minds the city of Jerusalem and the coming Jerusalem that we know is going to descend from heaven, and we will dwell there forever and ever with the Lord. We have visited wisdom psalms, the wisdom of God made manifest for us. We have been in penitential psalms where they hear the very emotional cry of David as he asks God to forgive and cover his sin. We have read psalms of lament. We have seen psalms of Hallel or praise. And in our journey, we've encountered even imprecatory psalms where the king was praying as a king, praying for victory over the enemies of Israel in this life, knowing God would hear and God would defend his nation. Now, I liken this particular psalm into a diamond among other diamonds, and in great clarity, we can see some wonderful things this morning because it is a rare psalm among the types of psalms in that this is a psalm of trust. And its companion, if you will, is Psalm 23, where David wrote of the beautiful truths we encountered some weeks ago in that great psalm. Now, if you remember in Isaiah 50, verse 10, as we studied that book, we found, "Who among you fears the Lord? Who obeys the voice of his servant? Who walks in darkness and has no light? Let him trust in the name of the Lord and rely upon his God." Now, I think it's important to trust the Lord. There you can say, duh. It is important to trust the Lord. Yet we often equate trust and faith as near synonyms, if you will. But the word trust in the Hebrew does indeed mean to have confidence, to be confident, to be bold, or to be secure. Now, all of these relating to belief when it lands in the mind and makes its way to the heart. Now, faith obviously shares the same characteristics, but it involves more the actions born out of trust that become visible as we live out our life as the people of God. Now, James gives us a bit of a contrast, if you will, or a comparative, where James says this in chapter 2. Someone will say, "You have faith and I have works. Show me your faith without your works, and I will show you my faith by my works. You believe there is one God." And he's in essence saying that belief is more than simply head knowledge. "You do well. Even the demons believe and tremble. But do you want to know, O foolish man, that faith without works is what?
Dead.
So too, trust without faith is dead." And if we back it up to what we're going to look at this morning, we will well see that faith is what makes trust visible. And James gives us some ideas on how to outwardly express our works. And this morning, King David is going to teach us how, by inspiration of the Spirit, to outwardly reveal that we trust in the Lord. Now, he's going to deal with our attitude, so to speak. And I think we could all recognize that there are some people who outwardly are stalwart, so to speak, and you cannot see any visible expression of nervousness or fright or fear in a stressful situation. And others, you can just look at them and tell that they indeed are a mess. But this morning, we're going to find out exactly how we are to express trust visibly so others can indeed see, not that we are fearful, but quite the opposite, that we do indeed trust the Lord. Now, I will say the circumstances surrounding this psalm, or the reasons David authored or penned these words, is unknown. We're not sure at all what the situation was that led David to read this. However, we do have an indication in the Septuagint, which gives us the heading, not only a psalm of David, like it says in your and my Bible, but the Septuagint reads, a psalm of David before he was anointed as king. And this has led some to believe that this is talking about when King David was on the run from Saul. Others believe this may have been when he had the situation with Absalom, and many of us are familiar with that story as well. But we'll keep moving this morning, and what we can recognize is not whether it's Saul or Absalom that David is dealing with, but the fact is what David is teaching us is that God is faithful no matter your circumstances. And this should manifest itself outwardly. Now, we have multiple choice titles this morning, two in number. And I'm going to give you the opportunity to feel free to choose whichever you like, but I believe most are going to choose one over the other. So here is option number one. Our first title this morning, if you choose, is an exegetical dissertation on the characteristics of behavior and belief in the postmodern church era. Now, you can jot that down if you have enough ink in your pen, or you can choose this. Here's what we're going to talk about this morning. Everything in Psalm 27, it's all yours. It's all yours. That is our preferred title this morning. And what King David is actually doing is showing us how to appropriate the promises of God, how to activate them in our own lives, how to recognize that God is faithful, and he is going to indeed outwardly express his trust in the Lord. His faith will become visible, even in the midst of great adversity. Now, this is where we draw our title from. And while we know that not all Old Testament truths are applicable to the church, some are specific to Israel, what we do know is when we encounter a matter that concerns the nature and character of God, because God does not change, it's true in every age. It was true for Israel, and there it's true for you and me. God was faithful to Israel. God will be faithful to you and I. Amen? Amen. Now, in other words, everything in this chapter is yours, is mine as well. And Paul said in 2 Corinthians 4:15, for all things are for your sakes, that grace having spread through the many may cause thanksgiving to abound to the glory of God. Now, this is my heart's desire for our visit to the well this morning, that what we hear, what we read, causes thanksgiving to outwardly abound in our lives for God's glory. Are you on board this morning? Well, let's stand and read Psalm 27. We'll start with verses 1 through 6. We'll do the whole of the chapter this morning, but we'll break it down into three separate reads, beginning in verse 1 down to verse 6. Psalm 27. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked came against me to eat up my flesh, my enemies and foes, they stumbled and fell. Though an army may encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war may rise against me, in this I will be confident. One thing I have desired of the Lord, that will I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. For in the time of trouble he shall hide me in his pavilion. In the secret place of his tabernacle he shall hide me. He shall set me high upon a rock. And now my head shall be lifted up above my enemies all around me. Therefore I will offer sacrifices of joy in his tabernacle. I will sing, yes, I will sing praises to the Lord. God, we praise you this morning. We thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness to us. And God, we know that we can trust in you. You've got a proven track record. You've never failed us or anyone else. Your word has proven itself true time and again. And it will do so once again this morning. I pray our time not return void as you promised, but Lord, that it would accomplish the purpose for which you had the King write down these words for our benefit and your glory. Bring us to that place, we ask. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Now, I couldn't help but think, not only is our text like a rare diamond surrounded by other gems, but it's also a bit like walking through Monument Valley or hiking through that beautiful place in Utah where you can look to the right or the left and see glorious things. And we have verses that have made their way into both song and sermon for literally millennia. We have statements that have come out of these that have become banners over the church, including statements like the famous C.H. Spurgeon wrote, where he said from our verses, "He who fears God has nothing else to fear." Man, you can take that with you, can't you? "He who fears God has nothing else to fear." Many of your minds were probably humming the melody of the Donnie McClurkin song from Psalm 27. "One thing have I desired of the Lord, that will I seek after." Some of you may have been thinking of the song by Selah, "You are my hiding place." And all these beautiful truths that have stemmed from this particular psalm, be they in song or be they in prose. Now, this psalm is a rare gem surrounded by other gems indeed. A walk through Monument Valley, and I'll remind you, it's all yours. Everything in here is yours. Everything is here for you to appropriate. Because our subject is the nature and character of God, and what believing in Him, trusting in Him, living by faith in Him is going to manifest in your lives. Now, the first things we're going to find as we look at the opening six verses is what we can see that God has given us and is all ours are these things. God has given us light. He has given us salvation. He has given us fearlessness. He has given us confidence. He has given us a dwelling place where we can behold His beauty. We can inquire of Him. He is our hiding place. He sets our feet on a high rock and He lifts up our head in praise. How you can stay seated, I can't figure it out. That's worth standing up and shouting. Amen? All these things are ours. Now, just by way of information, this is the first incorporation of light as a metaphor in describing God in the whole of the Bible. Yet, it draws our minds to other applications of God being a light and exactly what that means, including Psalm 119, 105, where we're told, "Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path." So the word of God lights our way. Psalm 43:3 will tell us, "Oh, send out your light and your truth. Let them lead me. Let them bring me to your holy hill and to your" what? "Your tabernacle," your dwelling place. Jesus went as far to say in John 3:20, "For everyone practicing evil hates the light and does not come to the light, lest his deeds should be exposed. But he who does the truth comes to the light, that his deeds may be clearly seen that they have been done in God." Boy, did Jesus hit the bellwether there. There's a huge difference in knowing the truth and doing the truth. We are to do the truths of God's word, or to walk on the path that He has foreordained for His children. And what King David shows us here, understanding that the Lord is light and salvation, means or manifests itself in God being his strength, and fear is thereby defeated. Hence the words of Paul to Timothy, reminding the young pastor that God has not given us the spirit of timidity or fear, but a power, love, and a sound mind in 2 Timothy 1:7. Now, what David writes here is, does this not imply that the Lord is David's strength and remind us that the Lord has unlimited strength? So what was available to David? Unlimited strength. Now, we're not talking about physical strength, obviously. But what we are talking about, and let me just answer the question just so some of you don't have to mail it in or email it or call pastor's perspective. No, God cannot make a rock so big He can't pick it up. Not possible. People ask that question. God has limitless strength. But let me give you this very simplistic point of application so we can take it out into life. Let me remind you this morning that as a Christian, you have, here's the first of our three truths, everything you need to get through anything in life. You have everything you need to get through anything in life. Now, David says, "When my enemies come at me, they stumble and fall." David says, "Though an army surrounds me, I have nothing to fear." David says, "Though war rise against me, I have God confidence." And then he gives us the key to unlocking such an outward disposition. He says, "Because there's one thing I desire, and that will I seek after." and that is to be in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. He's speaking of this life. You know what that means? That means in this life, the beauty of the Lord can be held. The beauty of the Lord can be seen. You can experience and see the beauty of God in your life and in your circumstances. Inquiries in times of trouble can be made of Him. You can not only see the beauty of God, but you can see the beauty of petitioning God and asking God for the great and mighty things that He has in store for you. In this life, you can find a hiding place in the Lord. Ever feel like just hiding for a few minutes? Oh, come on. Fess up now. We've all wanted that little momentary getaway, and we can find that in the Lord. Listen, in this life, your feet can be set on a high rock. In this life, your head can be lifted in praise no matter what's going on around you. Everything you need in life you have from God. You've been given every spiritual blessing in heavenly places. Christian, this is all yours. So here's the question. Have you appropriated the promises? Have you tapped in? I like how one person put it. Have you cashed a check? Have you cashed in on what God has granted you? Now, it's interesting here that David talks about hiding in his pavilion. The Greek word for pavilion is sukkah, and it means a tabernacle or even a tent. And anyone in David's day reading this would easily understand what David was saying, because culturally, in David's time, if you went into someone's house, if you went into their tabernacle or even a tent, the person who owned the tent had you under their care for the whole of your stay. In other words, they were responsible for providing for you, and they were responsible for protecting you. And David said, I want to live in God's provision and God's protection all the days of my life. I say amen to that, David. Now, Psalm 121 reminds us, I will lift my eyes up to the hills. From whence comes my help? We're going to read this whole psalm because I just couldn't find a place to cut it off. From whence comes my help? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not allow your foot to be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve you from all evil. He shall preserve your soul. The Lord shall preserve your going out and your coming in from this time forth and even forevermore. David said, that's where I want to live. How about you? Let me ask the question. What are you dwelling on, Christian? Or what are you dwelling in? The beauty of the Lord or the ugliness of life? What's your focus? What's got your attention? Because the fact is this, both will determine your attitude and your outlook on life. Now, if you look at the beauty of the Lord, your outlook is going to be far different than those who focus on the ugliness of life and the perilous times that we now live in. In the Lord's pavilion is everything you need to get through anything that comes your way. Because being in His house means God is your provider and God is your protector. And when God is on your side, of whom should you be afraid? No one. Amen? Look at verses 7 to 10 as the king continues in this psalm or expression of trust. The king then says, Hear, O Lord, when I cry with my voice, have mercy also upon me and answer me. When you said, Seek my face, my heart said to you, Your face, Lord, I will seek. Do not hide your face from me. Do not turn your servant away in anger. You have been my help. Do not leave me nor forsake me, O God of my salvation. When my father and mother forsake me, then the Lord will take care of me. Again, this middle section highlights our last point and gives us an understanding as to why the Holy Spirit did not inspire David to write a heading over this, other than this is a Psalm of David, because the fact is we don't need to associate these truths with any given circumstance. They're applicable in all circumstances. Doesn't matter what we're going through. God is going to help us, as David says here. Now, I want you to remember something back when King Solomon had first built the temple and the Ark of the Covenant was being brought in, and they had a huge dedication ceremony, and thousands of oxen and sheep were sacrificed unto the Lord. And finally, the Ark of the Covenant was going to arrive in a permanent resting place. And Solomon, at this dedication ceremony, said to the Lord, What if your people start messing up? What if they become materialistic? What if they become idolatrous? What if they go after pagan deities? And the Lord said in 2 Chronicles 7:14, Well, Solly, if my people call by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, forgive their sin, and heal their land. And the Lord went on to say in 2 Chronicles 7:15, now my eyes will be open and my ears attentive to prayer made in this place. For now I have chosen and sanctified this house, that my name may be there forever, and my eyes and my heart will be there, what? Perpetually or continually. Now, this is what the Lord spoke when Solomon asked a blessing on the house that would home the Ark of the Covenant, the representation of God's presence on earth. Now, let me ask you, is God's presence on earth today? And what temple does he dwell in? He dwells in you. So what is God saying to you right now? He's saying, I'll hear your prayers. I'll hear you. You are home, temple of my Holy Spirit. David then says, you said seek your face, and I did. Now, there are various ways to interpret this, and I think they're all right, because the word face means the part that turns, or the point of the face that you would make the connection of. Now, you don't usually talk to the side of people's faces, right? We would talk to someone face to face, and the part that turns is what the Hebrew phrase or word actually means. Now, this could mean to seek the Lord's presence or to seek his attention. David is saying, Lord, you told me to seek your attention, and I'm doing that. The face also was representative in Hebraic literature of a character or nature or even the countenance of the person being engaged or addressed. And this would also be fitting. And David could be saying to the Lord, you told me to find out who you are, and that's what I'm doing. I'm seeking you out. I'm trying to find out more about you. Now, why David would, in the midst of all this, pray, Lord, don't turn your face from me? We don't really know. Don't turn away in anger. We're not really sure, but we do know that King David recognized the Lord would be his help. Now, in verse 10, David makes a statement, when my father and mother forsake me, and the words when my are not in the Hebrew text, and there's no evidence that David's father and mother ever forsook him, but he's simply implying a rhetorical device to draw a comparison, much as Jesus would do when he taught as well. Consider the words of Jesus in Luke 14:26. Jesus said, if anyone, say anyone. Anyone, that includes all y'all, right? If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and his mother and his wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, and his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. Now, if Jesus was not using this rhetorical device to draw a comparison, then he would be in violation of the fifth commandment, which says to honor your father and mother, that your days may be long on the earth. So what Jesus was saying was this: the way you love me ought to make the way you love your family look like hate by comparison. You ought to love me way more than you love anything or anybody else on this earth. Hello. I didn't write it. I'm just sharing it. Now, this is what David is doing. David is saying it's totally and completely unnatural for a parent to abandon their child or forsake them. And he's saying, you know, it'd be more likely for that to happen than for the Lord to forsake you or me. Now, this brings us to our next simplistic truth that's all yours, by the way, all mine, by the way, as a Christian and a child of God. Let me remind you, we have, and here's our second truth, every reason to trust and not fear. We have every reason to trust and not fear. Has God ever let you down?
No.
Has he allowed things that are hard?
Yes.
Has he gone through them with you?
So
God has never failed any of us. And therefore, trust is something that is established through a track record. And God has a perfect track record. And David tells us what is all ours here in these verses is mercy, favor, help, and care from one who has no equal and one who is all-powerful and all-knowing, who never leaves nor forsakes his children. And the key is what David says here in verse 9. He says, you've been my help. In other words, I'm counting on you to see the lies that are told about me and maybe expose them. I'm counting on you to defend me against accusations made against me. You have been my help, is what David is tapping into. Now, does God allow hard things?
Yes.
Yeah, he does. Do some forsake us in life who shouldn't?
Yes.
Yep. Does God?
No.
Never. As a matter of fact, in contrast, Psalm 34, David will later write in verses 16 to 19, the face of the Lord, the countenance of the Lord, the part that turns of the Lord, is against those who do evil, to cut off the remembrance of them from the earth. The righteous cry out, and the Lord hears and delivers them out of all their troubles. Do I need to read that again? And delivers them out of all their troubles. The Lord is near to those who have a broken heart and saves such as have a contrite or humble spirit. Many are the afflictions of the righteous. Amen to that. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of two-thirds. No. Delivers him out of them all. Now, this is what David is saying. This is the contrast he is drawing from us with his rhetorical statement about being forsaken by parents. God deals differently with his children than people deal with each other. God deals differently with his children than he does with those who do evil. The face, the countenance, the character, the nature of God is against evildoers, but the righteous can expect deliverance, salvation. The righteous can expect the nearness of the Lord even when life is difficult or even heartbreaking. Christian, are you appropriating God's promises? God has a love for you that makes human love for you look like hate by comparison. And it's true when life is at its best, and it's true when life is at its worst. Circumstances cannot change the level of God's love for you and for me. It's all yours, Christian. There's families in this church that are hurting right now, hurting in ways that we could never even imagine. Families who have lost those that they love in the opening 6 weeks of this 2015. It's been a year like they've never expected, a year like they never imagined. And I can assure you, and I can see it and bear witness of it, that God has been with them. And would their choice be that the things that have happened not happen? Well, of course it would. But the fact is, the Lord is hearing their cries. The Lord is keeping their tears in his bottle. He has not turned his face away from them. Even though circumstances may often feel like God wasn't watching, he let a loved one slip through his hands. That's not true. God was watching, and he still is. God is faithful. Amen. In Proverbs 18:10, we're told the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run to it and are safe. That's yours too. You have a strong tower to run to. And everything that God has promised he would be in the life of those who believe, and King David is pulling back the curtain so we can see them a little bit and see what trust exactly looks like when life is hard and enemies surround us. And what we can expect in those times and at all times is mercy, favor, help, and care from God. These are all yours. But are we doing as David said, seeking the Lord's face?
Thank you for joining us today on The Truth About God as Pastor Barry continues his series through Psalms entitled The Well. Please be sure to join us next week as Pastor Barry continues his message through Psalm 27 entitled It's All Yours.